Praise the Lord, everyone. I want to greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. Today, I want you to know a couple things about me. Number one, I am not a dogmatic speaker. I'm not one to try to conform everyone to my thought pattern, but also I am someone that is helping the church to understand what we're dealing with and what we're fighting against. I also know that I'm dealing with strong powers and principalities. I know that I'm dealing with spiritual wickedness in high places, and there will always be a fight involved when you're trying to stand for what God has said. I also want to reiterate some of the things that I was reiterating earlier, which is that you cannot evangelize and antagonize at the same time. So I don't want anyone to see this video and look at it as an attack on individuals or an attack on any community. I want you to understand that there is love with what I'm doing. There is truth to what I'm saying. And I'm doing this to encourage and equip the church so that the church can know that we are dealing with spirits that is driving the blurred lines in this nation. There is a spirit behind calling everything evil good and everything good evil. There's a spirit that attacks those who would tell the truth. And I want you to know about these spirits, and I'm not surprised at any complications and any problems that might occur in the middle of this presentation, because I know that I'm about to go into some very interesting places. So I just want you to go with me, and for those who will be looking at this later, I want you to take the time to really drink this in and know what we're speaking on tonight, and I want you to analyze that there's a spirit behind this. And the reason why I wanted to make sure, even though we had some technical problems, the reason why I wanted to make sure I got right back on here and say the same things is because the devil would have people think that I'm up here for hatred. The devil will have people think that I'm up here to pick on someone and make anyone feel bad, and I'm not here to do that. What I'm up here to do today is to expose a spirit that is behind the evil movements that's really messing up our church. And when I say the church and the hermaphrodite, I'm not only talking about the male, female demographic. I'm not only talking about the alternative lifestyle demographic. I'm talking about a spirit that is against everything that God has set forth. And I want to show you one of the base scriptures that this spirit tries to pervert in order to change the truth of God into a lie. One of the base scriptures that's used is Galatians chapter 3, verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. Here is the one where they try to use it. There is neither male nor female, for ye are one in Christ Jesus. The hermaphroditic spirit tries to use the scripture to say that anything and everything is sanctioned, that we're not Jews or Greeks, we're not bond or free, we're not males nor females, we're all just one in Jesus Christ. So the roles of a man is no longer the roles of a man. The roles of a woman are no longer the roles of a woman. We're all just here for Christ. But I would have you to know that this scripture is talking about the work of salvation. We are kings and priests in Jesus Christ through the work of salvation. That's why we have his titles. We have the titles of our king. We have the titles of our priests, because we are found in him. But the roles that we have as humans still remain. Jesus said when we get to heaven, we will be as the angels, neither married nor given in marriage. But here on this earth, men are men, women are women. And I don't want you to click away thinking that this is just another message to talk about a certain community. No, I'm talking about disorder in the church, the spirit of the hermaphrodite as a whole. And in order for me to do this, I want you to know some of these terms. I'm going to go to this whiteboard over here. One of the terms that I want you to know where the word hermaphrodite comes from, hermaphrodite. This term, it is actually the combination of two names. The first name this term comes from is Hermes, the god Hermes. And the next word in this name comes from the goddess Aphrodite. So we got this masculine name and we got this feminine name put together, so we have the word hermaphrodite. It is the term Hermes and Aphrodite. And you will see this term, I'm going to bring this up because there's a spirit that's driving it. And I want you to know that in the church we have the spirit of Hermes. If you were here for the teaching on the Kundalini, this is going to be very interesting to you. Because the spirit of Hermes and Aphrodite in the church has to do with the Kundalini awakening, and I'm going to come back to it. But I want you to know what Hermes is a god of. He's a god of messages. Messages. He's a god of heralding. He's the god of music. He's a god that controls souls. I know I write like someone shaking a small dog. Don't get mad at me. But this is what the god Hermes does. Now, I wonder where they herald messages at and sing music at in order to control souls. I wonder where that happens at. And Aphrodite is the god of lust, sensuality. Sexuality. That's what the Aphrodite part of this is. So I wonder, where do they put messages together, sing music, herald a sermon, sing music, control souls, where there's a whole bunch of lust, sensuality, and sexuality? I wonder where that's happening in the world. All right, so this is just the tip of the iceberg. I don't want you to be taken by this, because we got a long way to go. I'm not going to be here very long, hopefully, but I want you to know about it. Praise the Lord. So coming back to our stand, I want you to learn about these spirits that's coming to the church. And I wanted to give you a little bit of background of what Hermaphrodites was and what he did. What happened according to Greek mythology is Hermaphrodites was the son of Hermes and Aphrodite. He was extremely beautiful. He was bathing one day, and a water nymph by the name of Sarmaces saw him bathing, and she wanted to be with him so badly that she attacked him while he was bathing. And according to the myth, she prayed and cried out to the gods that they would bond her with Hermaphrodites. He was a male initially, but she cried out to the gods to bond her with him, and her body went to his body, and then he picked up the characteristics of both a male and a female. So that's where we get the modern term and the modern iconography of the hermaphrodite. It is from the story of Hermaphrodites, which I told you just now. It's the name of Hermes and Aphrodite together. This spirit is attacking the church for a reason. It is not only to introduce a certain lifestyle. I'm not here to pick on any lifestyle or anybody right now. I'm here out of love. I'm here out of concern, because I see something around the corner that's going to attack the church. I see something around the corner that's going to hate the ministry. I see something that is coming around the corner that's going to attack churches, and we have to be on guard, and we have to stand like never before. So I want to help you to understand that this movement is occultic. The spirit is occultic. I'm one who have come from different mystery systems. I grew up in the church, but at age 13, I began to learn about the Nubians, the Gosners. I began to learn about the 5% nation, the Moors, the Elks, the Moor Science Temple. I began to learn about these things, and it got to a point where I was so deep that they told me that if I came to any more meetings, that I would have to stand on my square and become a Mason and enter into the ancient Egyptian order. And that was said to me. And at that time, I knew that if I was to do these things, I would lose my soul, because I am not one to stop. I'm one to dig. I'm one to keep going. And I want you to be aware of how these mystery systems use certain symbols and use certain doctrines in order to subverse people. And I want to show you different things in the Bible that they love to use. I'm going to go back to my whiteboard. I'm going to show you some of the things in the Bible that these mystery systems, this hermaphroditic spirit, took out of the Bible. I want to show you a few names. First of all, and I know that you don't see my head, but I really want you to pay attention to this whiteboard. One of the names that I want you to see is the name Solomon. The name Solomon is a name that they like to use in the mystery systems because it is solar and moon. This is where you get your word Monday, mon or moon's day. This is soul as in where you get solar. So you have the masculine energy and you have the female energy, feminine energy. Another name that these mystery systems like to use, El Issa Beth. See, El is the Canaanite deity of fire. That's who El is. He's the Canaanite deity of fire, the storm, or you can even say the sun. Issa is also, I know that if you are a Muslim, you already know what I'm about to say about Issa, because Issa is used as a name for Jesus. But Issa is a short form of Isis. This is sun, Isis, moon, and then Beth, which means house. So this is the house of the sun and moon. See, there's a reason why these spirits are in the church. There's a reason why these spirits are in the church. Instead of it being God's house as it should be, it's the house of the sun and moon. We're wondering why our sons are turning this way. We're wondering why our daughters are turning this way, why these spirits are taking over. I'm telling you, it's a demonic witchcraft spirit. It is a demonic witchcraft spirit, and I want you to know about it. Also, this Zai and An. This is Anubis. This is Isis. So this is once again a feminine energy and a masculine energy. These are the things out of the Bible that these cult practices use. I'm going to give you some more. These cult practices use these things in order to invoke a certain amount of power inside of their communities. So I want to show you something that you probably never thought of before. This is a pentagram. This is a pentagram. Everybody knows about the pentagram. Everybody talks about the five-pointed star, the goat head, and so forth. This penta means five. This is where you get your, like, Pentecost 50. But what most people don't realize is there's something else that we've seen all the time. Here is the arrow of the male, which goes in. This is the cup of the female. This is the cup of the female which receives. So when you combine the arrow of the male, the cup of the female, you end up with this. You end up with the six-pointed star. The six-pointed star is a hexagram. I showed you the pentagram. This is the hexagram. This is also a powerful symbol in witchcraft. Now, I'm not saying the symbol is evil in and of itself. What I am telling you is this symbol is used in witchcraft. The hexagram is where you get your words. They put a hex on you. They put a hex on you. So what is a hex? A hex is a spell. I put a spell on you. I put a six on you. And now when you go forth to your stores and you're going to your hospitals and you're going all around the world and everybody's sick and dead and dying and you're trying to figure out why they want you to be 6 feet apart. Why do they want you to stand in the hex? Why do they want your distance in the hex? I'm not saying that it's, you know, done on purpose, but what I am saying to you, there is a zeitgeist. There is a spirit in the world. Also, along with the hex, you have in Freemasonry this symbol. This is the arrow of the man. This is the cup of the woman. This is the arrow of the man. This is the cup of the woman in Freemasonry. This is something that I want you to understand. There's a spirit behind the hermaphrodite. Okay, now I want to get back to what the spirit tries to do. What this spirit tries to do, it tries to tell you that every bit of order that God put in place is not the true order. What God made men to be, men don't have to be that. What God made sisters to be, sisters don't have to be that. And when you get up and preach that God has made a specific order inside of this world for our families, for our lives, for our homes, for our churches, you are looked at as if you hate people, or that you are dogmatic, or that you're doing this only because you want to be able to rule over women. But I want to tell you something. If you read this Bible right, the authority of the man is predicated upon his responsibility for his wife, his responsibility for his children. No man has the right to say, I have authority over my home and authority over my family and authority over my children, if he don't take authority and if he don't take responsibility. Men have to stand up. They have to do as God has said. And if they would do that, then God would establish order in their lives. But the problem is, men want to be in charge, but they don't want God to rule them in their everyday occurrences. They just want to use the Bible to say that God said this and that and the other about me. But men and women need to get in line with what God has said so that God can save our lives, he can save our families. So I'm going to show you some more things when it comes to the symbols of the hermaphrodite. I told you that hermaphrodite, let me put this word back on here, hermaphrodite. This is a term that is dual. It is the word Hermes and Aphrodite. Here is music, heralding, souls. Hermes is the conductor of souls. Lust, Aphrodite, sex, aesthetics, concerned about how things look. That's why aesthetics, we got to wear the right color robe, we got to have the right color collar on, we got to wear the right color shirt. You ain't no bishop, so why you have on purple? You're not a apostle, why you have on red? And all this kind of foolishness. But at the same time, nobody living nothing, you're not living none of the colors. But we better have the right aesthetics. And that's what the spirit of Aphrodite does. It says, we're going to do great music. We're going to preach real good. We're going to conduct souls. But we're full of lust, sexuality, sensuality. And we got to make sure our aesthetics are right. See, we got to get better with this, saints of God. There's a spirit that's in the church. But I'm going to show you the symbol of Hermes. And this, if you saw the teaching on the Kundalini Awakening. If you saw the teaching on the Kundalini Awakening, this is going to really trip you out. The standard of Hermes, the symbol of Hermes, the standard of Hermes is this. Now, I know I don't draw very well. My son should be here to draw wings. This is a pair of wings. You've seen this at the doctors. Here's a staff. The standard of Hermes, here's a serpent, a snake, wrapped around the staff. Here's another snake, two snakes wrapped around the staff. You've seen this at the doctors. This is the symbol of Hermes. This is the standard of Hermes. And I said to myself, oh my goodness, now I get something. Now I understand why we don't care if he's preaching the truth, because this is the standard of Hermes. We don't care if we're walking in the light, because this is the standard of Hermes. We don't care if the preacher is doctrinally sound, because this is the standard of Hermes. The standard of Hermes is not the truth. The standard of Hermes is not sound doctrine. The standard of Hermes is, long as I had the Kundalini Awakening this Sunday. If you saw the teaching on the Kundalini Awakening, then you will understand what I'm talking about. The only thing I don't care if it's right, I don't care if we're in the scripture, I don't care if it's sound, I don't care if it's the truth. The only thing I care about is, did I shout today? The only thing I care about is, did I speak in tongues today? The only thing I care about is, did I prophesy today? I don't care what the truth is, I don't care what the Bible says, I don't care what God say, did we get hype in church today? Why? Because the standard of the hermaphrodite is the Kundalini awakening. This is called the tree of life. This is called the tree of life. I'm going to show you this in another symbol. The tree of life. Here's the other symbol that the spirit of hermaphrodite has. And I might really lose some folk now. We all know about the Ankh. And I told you about Elizabeth. This is the sun, moon, house. This is the house of the sun and the moon. And I know I'm writing very sloppily. But what happens is this represents the trees or the groves. This is the tree. This section right here. This is the groves. This is the groves. This represents the sun. So this is the sun. A ball. All right? So the moon goddess Isis, but when you get into the Semitic realms, Isis' name in the Semitic realms is Ashtaroth, or the groves, the trees. So you got the sun on top of the trees. In order to make the Ankh, you have the sun on top of the trees. You have the sun, I want to say that again, the sun star on top of the trees. So where have we seen a star on top of the trees? I wonder what's happening next month. That's going to have people all over America. Praise the Lord. We hear you not losing us. Thank God. I wonder what's happening all over America where people are about to have an Ankh sitting in their house. I wonder what's happening next month that's going to have the sun star sitting on the grove tree. I'm saying this to you today because there's a spirit that is driving. There's a spirit that is driving filthiness in the church and will tell you that everything that God said, he don't mean that. He didn't say that. But I want to show you in the scripture that everywhere God has spoken about men and women, he meant what he said. If I go to 1 Timothy chapter 3 in verse 2, it says a bishop must be blameless, the husband of one wife. I want to tell you that that's what he meant. He didn't mean something ambiguous. If you go to 1 Corinthians chapter, I'm going to go to chapter 7 first. It says, now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me, 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 1, it is not good for a man to touch a woman, nevertheless to avoid fornication. Let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. I'm here to tell you today that that's what he meant. He meant that. He meant let every man have a wife and let every woman have her own husband to avoid fornication. He didn't say let every person have their own person. And that's how they would have you to read. They would have you to think that's what he's saying. Let every person have their own person. But the scripture is solid. It meant what it said. Let me go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. It says, be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Now I praise you, brethren, that ye remember me in all things and keep the ordinances as I have delivered them to you. But I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God, and every man praying or prophesying with his head covered dishonor of his head. So what I'm saying to you today, I know that people like to say that these scriptures are not talking about actual roles of men and women, and I can go on and on and on and show you the differentiation between men and women. I can show you this over and over again in the Bible to let you know that God meant what he said. He was not saying that everybody just be everything. He's not saying, because the scripture says that there are no Jews, Greek, bond, nor free, male, nor female, but all are one in Christ Jesus. He was not saying that to say to us that we can do anything and be any kind of way. He said that to us so that we know that we are found in Christ. That is talking about salvation. Just like when people like to say God has no respect of persons, that scripture is about judgment. That scripture is about judgment. God is no respecter of persons in judgment. But when it comes to the favor of God, you can't live in every kind of way. You can't do everything you want to do. You have to live holy. You must be righteous. You must walk in the character of Christ to receive the blessings of Christ. You cannot prostitute the Lord. You must be married to him. There's a spirit of the hermaphrodite that is in the church that wants to come against all the order that God has set in place, that wants to come against all the truth that God has set in place. But the Bible says that the church has to be the pillar and the ground of truth. That's why I'm teaching what I'm teaching. That's why I'm saying what I'm saying, because the church has to stay the pillar and ground of truth. If the truth is not found in Congress, if the truth is not found in politics, if the truth is not found in our homes and in our communities, when people come to the house of God, they should see brothers being brothers. They should see sisters, being there for one another. They should see saints being saints. We have to get out of the spirit of the hermaphrodite that would teach us to get out of our callings, to get out of our stance with God. We have to put these things away, church. I'm teaching it right now because, like I said, I talked on Facebook a little earlier. The truth was the truth before C-19. It's the truth during C-19. It's going to be the truth after C-19. I'm telling you right now, you can run all you want to all these places that is operating under the spirit of the hermaphrodite. I'm going to show you another example of it. I'm going to show you another biblical example of it. Let's go over here. People know that the spirit of the hermaphrodite is an evil spirit, but they don't know that it's in a clear example in the Bible. In the Old Testament, that spirit's name was Jezebel. In the New Testament, this same spirit was named Herod. King Herod. They both had suspicion. They both killed anyone who challenged their authority. The kicker is Jezebel's greatest enemy was Elijah. The kicker is that Herod's greatest enemy was John the Baptist. The Baptist, who came in the spirit of Elijah. John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah, and Herod, something in Herod, had to get rid of Elijah. And now I want to ask you, this is the question I want to ask as I begin to shut this thing down. I want to ask you, what is moving in you right now? Is there a spirit in you just like the spirit that was in Herod? I don't know what it is about this young man who's on this microphone talking, but I need to kill him. I'm going to say something about him. I don't agree what he say. I'm going to fight against whatever he say. What is it moving in your heart that's causing you to rebel against an obvious truth? I'm speaking as a person who was nearly initiated, I would say, into some of these occult systems when I was asked to stand on my square. I'm saying to you right now, don't let that spirit live within you that will fight against the truth. Don't let that spirit live within you. It's something just, I know what he's saying is right, but I'm happy in what I'm in. I'm happy doing what I'm doing. I'm happy going where I'm going. Don't let that spirit fight you. Realize that there's a spirit on the church that want us to put our hands down. We're giving up. The church is giving up. And it's saying, well, this is the way of the world. This is how things are. So we got to get with 2020. It's a new year. It's a new program. I'm here to tell you, God said I'm the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. I pray that you would take what I say. The Bible says if any man say that he is a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things I say are of the Lord. I'm praying that you would really be before the Lord for your loved ones, really be before the Lord with your families, who are trapped under the spirits of Jezebel and her prophets. Jezebel at Mount Carmel, the Bible says that they had church all day. They had church all day long, 12 hours having church. 12 hours or more having church. They even cut themselves. You ever notice that people that go to these churches are bound by all types of spirits? They're all kinds of self-destructive. They even cut themselves. They say, oh, send the fire, send the fire, send the fire. But God didn't accept their sacrifice. Baal couldn't answer them. Baal couldn't answer them. So I'm telling you now, we got to come back to the living God. We have to live in the truth, and we have to stand on what's right. So if you've missed this teaching today, I hope you go back and you can see the many examples of the spirit of the hermaphrodite. It's not just a spirit about one type of community or one type of living. It is a spirit that hates divine order. It's a spirit that tears up your marriages. It's a spirit that's tearing up your homes. It's a spirit that's tearing up your children. So I want you to go back. I want you to see that everything I'm saying today is because I'm concerned. I'm concerned something's wrong with the church. And I'm saying to pray and be before the Lord. I thank you for looking at this. I wanted to give you this synopsis. I could teach all day. I could go on and on and on. But I'm going to come to an end. And I hope that some of you will send me questions of things that you like to know about, things that you like to be covered. I'm a very deep studying man. I am a person that believes in the Bible from Genesis 1 and 1 to Revelations 22 and 21. I'll never play around with God and his people. The Lord has been too good and too gracious to me. He's given me another chance. And with everything I have in me, I fight for what's right. I love you. God bless you. And I appreciate you tuning in.